This video is sponsored by Squarespace, a great all-in-one platform for starting your website and doing some fun stuff on it.
Season's greetings, everybody. Today, we're going to be talking about the 2002 film The Christmas Shoes, because Christmas is right around the corner.
It was almost Christmas time, and there I stood in another line, trying to buy that last gift or two.
The movie is based on a country song of the same name, which is about a guy who buys some shoes for a kid who wants them for his dying mother so she can look good for Jesus. And right off the bat, I feel like this is the sort of movie that was made for me. The original song is so morbid and wonderful. The movie was made by Hallmark, my favorite studio. It stars Rob Lowe for some reason. It's just my kind of thing. What's more, the film does not disappoint. It's weird as hell, thought-provoking, and all around a really interesting and worthwhile time.
Sir, I wanna buy these shoes.
Anyway, that's this video. The Christmas Shoes, an in-depth analysis. Part 1. Christmas. So, for around the first half of the film, The Christmas Shoes is an incredibly standard experience. The protagonist, Robert, Rob Lowe, is obsessed with his job as a lawyer and fixated on the idea of getting a new, bigger house, so much so that he comes home late every night and frequently misses big events with his daughter.
I'm sorry, I had a bunch of case law I had to look at.
And so, he has to learn the most Christmassy lesson that a person can learn. Don't put buying stuff and working over your relationship with your family. And this section of the movie is utterly devoted to telling us that this lesson is really important to learn. For one thing, a character just says it. Rob's mom tells him, don't just make money, make memories.
Robert, don't just make money.
I hear you.
Make memories.
I'm listening.
And of course she's supposed to be right. She's nice and old, and she dies a few minutes after saying this. You know, obviously, we're supposed to think she's making a good point here. But we also learn about the importance of this idea through juxtaposition. See, counterpointing Robert and his family are the Andrews, who transparently function as models of good behavior. Where Robert makes a comfortable amount of money but always wants more, the Andrews family are blue-collar, poor but happy with what they have.
Are we poor?
No, we just don't have a lot of money.
We got everything we need.
Where Robert pressures his wife to get a job so they can afford a big house.
Go ahead and print out these new resumes for you. We're gonna need you back in the workforce if we're moving to Madison Hill.
It doesn't matter to Big Daddy Andrew that his wife, Maggie, doesn't bring in any money. Where Robert shirks responsibility for his community and gets mad at his wife for volunteering with the choir.
Why can't somebody else volunteer? Why can't somebody else be responsible?
Maggie Andrew was the original choir teacher, and she loved her work. On every level, the Andrews serve as a moral beacon, the people who prize memory over money. And grounding this idea, of course, is the central object of the movie, the Christmas shoes. At the beginning of the movie, Robert sees the shoes fall off of a truck, and they have no meaning to him whatsoever. He just gives them to a store.
It's not exactly our style, but we'll give it a try.
All right, thanks a lot.
But what he doesn't see is that these shoes have the capacity to hold tremendous value. Not in a gauche consumerist sense, but in the associations we might have with them. On two separate occasions, Maggie talks about old dancing shoes she had, how important they were to her in a very personal, emotional way.
I used to have a pair of shoes just like that. I know it sounds corny, but whenever I put them on and I danced, it was just wonderful.
So, through all of these mechanics, the film establishes for us a set of oppositions. In column A is the familial, the kind, the appreciation of what you have. Considering the clear religious overtones of the movie, we might even say this is the side of God, the moral and Christian order he gave to us. And in column B is the perversion of these ideas, the rejection of family life, the absence of personal kindness, the lust for objects and constant labor to buy more things, a rejection of God's order. And looking at this first act, at the set of oppositions, we might think that the trajectory of this movie was completely obvious and kinda trite. Our friend Robert is gonna move from column B, the derivative and bad, to column A, the pure and good. And his doing that will be connected to these shoes. We know the song, right? We know what's gonna happen next. Maggie is gonna get sick, and her kid, Nathan, is gonna wanna get the shoes for her. And then Robert's gonna see how much the kid wants the shoes, and he'll be moved by it, and then he'll reclaim their symbolic meaning, come to understand all the good stuff we've been talking about. It's all so easy, so appropriate for a schlocky Hallmark movie. But that's not what we get. Part 2. Shoes. Okay, if we looked at the song, The Christmas Shoes, and wanted to ask, what is this song about on the broadest possible level, how would we answer? Well, we could say a few things. It's about appreciating the Christmas spirit. It's about the goodness of charitable acts and doing nice stuff for poor children. It's about a childlike and naive take on the afterlife, the belief that it matters what shoes you wear to heaven.
I wanted to look beautiful. If Mama meets Jesus tonight.
But here's an even broader answer. The Christmas Shoes is about a transaction. It centers on a kid walking into a store and trying to buy something he doesn't need with money. Money that probably had to come from doing labor of some kind. And look, I understand that that observation probably sounds silly to you. So what if the kid wanted to buy the thing? People buy lots of stuff, and it seems almost petty to point to that as some big important aspect of the song. But here's the thing. As trivial as that fact might seem, I bring it up here because this simple thing utterly defines the second half of this movie. And ultimately, it ends up bringing the story to some unexpected and downright confusing places. So, the first thing I'd want you to notice is just how important the nature of the shoes as objects that need to be bought is to this film. Like, the original song takes place over the course of around a minute. The kid walks in, wants to buy the shoes, doesn't have enough money, has a guy buy them for him, and then that's it. And in that brevity, it doesn't matter all that much where the money to buy the shoes comes from. The kid puts some coins on the counter, but we don't know where he got those coins from, right? Maybe they were his allowance, maybe he just kinda had that money. It's not something the song addresses, so it's not where our attention naturally falls. But in the film, which takes place over the course of around a month, getting the money to purchase these shoes becomes the central conflict of Nathan's arc. From the moment Nathan learns that his mom is dying and hears that she loves and misses some shoes, he is utterly devoted to getting money and buying them for her. And since his dad won't hear him out, even for a second,
Dad? Dad, I really need to make some money. Dad, look, please,
Nathan.
He has to collect cans on the street, and Nathan does this constantly. Throughout the second act, he is usually in the process of collecting cans and getting incredibly excited about it.
This is great!
Great? What, it's an empty, dirty can. What are you talking about?
Yeah, but it's worth a nickel. And if I get 20 of them, that's a dollar. And if I get a whole lot more, that's even more money. And then I can buy my mom a special Christmas present.
And the film draws our attention to the ways that Nathan's actions come at the direct cost of spending time with his family. In one scene where he goes out to collect cans, Nathan's dad ominously tells him to come back soon.
You sure you don't want to stay?
It's Christmas Eve, Dad. I've got stuff I have to do.
Okay. Hurry back.
This is a clear suggestion that Maggie will be dead within the next few hours, and that if the kid is gone for too long, he might miss his mother entirely. And yet, he needs to go. This object is just that important. What's more, the film clearly understands Nathan's can collecting as endearing and inspiring. In one of my favorite scenes in the movie, this nice teacher, we'll call him Noodles because he makes me smile, plants a little can treasure trove for the boy.
Wow!
Hey!
Look at all of them!
What's going on here?
It's a jackpot!
How about that?
You were right! This is a great place for cans.
Yeah? Cans?
Each one is worth 5 cents, and there's probably about 100 of them. So that's $5.
It's worthy of note that Noodles knows why the boy wants the can so much, knows that it's this important gift for his dying mother. And yet, Noodles doesn't respond by getting the kid what he wants, just going to the store and buying the thing for $10. Instead, the act of labor is posed here as inherently valuable. Even though Nathan would explicitly want to have the shoes without collecting these cans because he takes the gift incredibly seriously, the time-consuming labor he has to put into getting them is understood as a good thing. And so, he gets the reward of doing more work. $5 in cans. Not even enough. And I'm hoping that, right about now, a thought has started bubbling in your brains. This is all super duper weird. Like, the protagonist, Robert, is supposed to change, right? He's supposed to look at this kid and realize that he should value his family more and not endlessly labor all the time. But how can he do that when the kid is just like him? Values the same things, works constantly to buy stuff, even when it comes at the cost of spending limited time with loved ones. To put it simply, if these shoes are a symbol of the goodness of labor, then why on earth would they get our protagonist to stop laboring?
It's not like I didn't want to go to the concert. I had 10,000 phone calls and deans in my office. Sure, you don't want to stay.
It's Christmas Eve, Dad. I've got stuff I have to do.
Okay.
So, what can we do with all of this? Well, I, for one, would want to start searching for some tasty loopholes. There must be some difference between Robert and Nathan, between the ways that they understand work. Maybe Robert sees labor in a bad, harmful way, and Nathan comes at it from a healthier place. And if that's true, then the movie can start to make sense to us again. What does Robert have to learn? How to work good, I guess. And this is where the brilliance of the Christmas shoes really shines through. Because at every moment the film announces to us, nope, there is no difference here. And every difference you try to come up with will be met with resistance. You're not gonna get out of this problem that easy. Like, here's one idea I had as I watched the movie. What if the difference between Nathan and Robert is that Nathan's work is motivated by emotion and sentimentality, and Robert's is not? Yeah, that could work, right? Whereas Nathan is out there trying to buy these shoes because he thinks they're incredibly meaningful, Robert's just trying to buy a big house. We can read him as the raw consumerist type, chasing the next object for no other reason except that it's there and he wants it. And if that's the case, the message could be clear. Labor, labor as much as you need to, but not just for the sake of it. There should be some deep-seated explanation as to why you want the object that you're working for.
And then I can buy my mom a special Christmas present.
But the Christmas shoes looks at that theory and is like, nope, that's not gonna work, bro. In one scene toward the middle of the movie, Robert talks about his grandfather to some clients he's representing.
Land prices fall and you've gotta sell.
Then they buy at fire sale prices. It ain't the fish that's endangered, it's us.
My grandfather was a farmer during the Depression. The bank took his land.
And while this speech is never explicitly connected to Rob's desire to get a new house, I think the relationship is fairly obvious. Because his grandfather lived through times of economic deprivation, because he lost everything, Robert is now, among other things, devoted to making sure that that never happens to him, his family, or anyone else for that matter. He feels he needs to work all the time to get his wife to bring in a substantial income, to buy a big, safe house, because of the fear that it could all be taken away from him. Now, we might say that's an irrational impulse, but so is buying Christmas shoes so your mom can wear them to heaven, right? I mean, the irrationality of that desire is what makes it fun in the first place. The point is that, exactly like Nathan, Robert is not just a vapid materialist. The house means something to him. He's working toward it for reasons that go far beyond him liking to buy stuff. And as such, we can't really find our distinction here, because both characters are similarly motivated by sentimentality and emotion. But okay, here's another theory I had. What if the difference between Robert and Nathan is that Nathan helps people with his work and Robert doesn't? That's kinda nifty, I think. Like, Nathan doesn't work for himself, he's doing it for his mom. She loves and misses these shoes, and he wants to do something nice for her.
Every time I put them on, I just felt so special.
Meanwhile, maybe Robert is just a selfish dude, doing work that only satisfies his own ego. And the message we can take from that is perfect. Help people. It's good to work, but you should help people in the process. Nice. But the Christmas shoes, like a big mean troll, completely stamps out this idea. Toward the very end of the movie, a bunch of Robert's farmer clients come to talk to his wife, and they say this.
Is this your husband, ma'am?
Yes.
Well, I sure do appreciate everything Mr. Layton's done for us. You know, he's been burning the midnight oil, and that's hard. But we'd be lost without him. Your husband has given us hope this Christmas.
And I don't even feel like I gotta dive too deep on this one. Like Nathan, Robert does help people. He helps them so much, all the time. Clearly, that's not the difference between these two characters. And in the very last scene of the Christmas shoes, the veil is lifted. Around 15 years pass, and it's Christmas again. Robert and Nathan stand next to each other, in front of the graves of their respective mothers. Nathan is now becoming a doctor.
In college?
Medical school.
Just like Robert, who tries to make up for the economic deprivation his grandfather faced by working as a lawyer, Nathan wants to heal the sick, help people like his mom. Nathan wears the hat that Robert wore in his childhood. And here, it's as though the movie is coming out and telling us, you want to know why you haven't been able to find a difference between these characters? Why every theory of yours has fallen flat? It's because these two guys are the same person, identical in every important way. And what message can we possibly learn from that? At the beginning of the movie, Robert's a guy who works a lot to buy something and doesn't spend much time with his family. But then, he sees something inspirational and miraculous that forces him to change. A kid who works a lot to buy something and doesn't spend much time with his family. That's really it. That's all we can say. Part 3. Conclusion. In the first part of this video, we talked about two columns of opposing ideas. We had column A, the good one, with living for your loved ones and deriving joy from what you already have. And we had column B, the bad one, with ignoring your loved ones and crass consumer culture and all that stuff. But the nature of these shoes, as well as the plot surrounding them, comes to disturb the cleanliness of that opposition. Because they simultaneously belong to both columns. They represent not laboring so much or caring about material possessions.
The smallest of miracles can change our lives. A laughing child, the car that needs fixing, even a pair of shoes.
And they represent the importance of labor and buying material possessions.
Each one is worth 5 cents, and there's probably about 100 of them. So that's $5.
That's a lot of cans.
And that's a lot of money.
And on some level, I find that a bit stressful. I have this temptation to reach into the screen and be like, but that doesn't make any sense. You can't be something and its negation at the same time. You can't be clean and dirty inside a room and outside of it. These are mutually exclusive properties. And if the movie wants to be about making memories over money, it can't also be about making money over memories. But, you know, The Christmas Shoes is about that. And what's more, it doesn't seem to mind being about that. Maybe there is no message here. Maybe the set of oppositions the film establishes in its first act, family versus labor, commodity versus sentimentality, purity versus impurity, don't actually work. By the end of the movie, all we have is a series of arbitrary moral intuitions. It's bad that Robert worked so much. I'm happy he changed. And it's nice that Nathan worked so hard to get his mom those shoes, and good on him for going to med school. There is no explanation here. The film seems to laugh at the idea that there ever could be one. So that's the video, and now it's time for my Patreon question and outro and stuff, but first a word from our sponsors. Squarespace is a great and really easy to use website, especially if you want to start a portfolio or something like that. There are all these great preset portfolios, and I don't know, I wanted something with just one cow on it, a website with one gorgeous cow, and it was super duper easy to find that and a template that worked for it. So I hope you have luck too, and you can get 10% off your first purchase if you use the coupon code BIGJOEL, so have fun with that. Okay, thanks to my patrons, thanks to everyone who watched the video, and now it's time for my Patreon question of the week. Boop doop boop ba. Edgardo Soto asks, how did you get to be so cute? I don't know, thank you. Okay, bye, that's the answer. It was almost Christmas Eve, and everybody was looking at me, trying to make me the best the guy, and everybody looked in my eyes, they told me it only came once a year, when Jesus Christ came to our fear, and everybody looked down at me, and thank you patrons, and you gave me so much. Yes, I didn't buy these shoes for my mama, please. Ooh, yeah, it only comes once a year.